Hey, I'm Dr. Bo, Boba Benko, that's me. I wanted to talk to you guys about myself. I don't talk a lot about my entire history, so I wanted to take that time, record this episode for sharing my story and my passion, my why on this entire journey, why I'm so passionate about longevity and preventative care. So let's get into it. I was born in 1983 in Moscow, Russia. There's actually a very cool documentary that was made about the process of escaping the USSR at the time and leaving for a better life. That documentary is called Stateless. So it was interesting to watch, easily to say. And yeah, if you're interested in checking it out, I believe it's available for purchase for like $1.99 or something like that on iTunes. And things like that. I'll try to link it down below or in the show notes. And yeah, so that's what we did. We immigrated from communist Russia in 1987. And when we got to America, both of my parents had master's degrees in engineering, both of them in Russia. And so when they got here, of course, it was a little bit different. And my father went into construction and my mother went into accounting. So very smart folks. I have to say I'm very grateful for, you know, I kind of, the grand scheme of life and everything, I'm very grateful for these genetics and these kind of natural gifts and being in this environment culture that really put a high value on academia and knowledge, gaining knowledge. So unfortunately the stress, I think at the time, certainly got to my father. And he ended up dying of a heart attack at the age of 41. So pretty young, and I'm actually 37 now as I'm recording this. And so they say when the medical system is looking at your history, your risk factors, it's very much looking at how likely you are to have problems develop, because that's what's gonna cost the system the most, and also cost you or the patient, me, the biggest problem. So how can we help avoid some of that? So I would say, again, the healthcare system currently is set up more to fix problems once they arise than it is to really prevent them. But there is a little bit of preventative type conversations that do go on. So as I grew up, again, my mother, I'll give her a ton of credit for providing this kind of push toward a healthier lifestyle. Of course, came here as a young kid in the early 90s. The Cold War was going on still as we escaped Russia. So I kind of didn't want to be associated with that Russian culture, but I love the American culture. You know, I grew up on all these great shows, Full House and Family Matters and things like that. The Cosby Show, which we don't talk about anymore. Ooh. But the main thing that again, as I started getting more and more understanding and growing up a little bit more, saw that American culture was about this kind of excess. And of course, as I started learning more and more, the rates of obesity, heart disease, and things like that became very prevalent. And further into my career and my education, a lot of these problems and the statistics that we see are very preventable. And so again, my mother, as a kid, would, you know, she'd cook me salmon and all these oatmeals and things that, like, again, I wanted like a Big Mac. You know, I wanted this American kind of ideal dream, but again, she was going to the health food store and if I had a cough or something, she'd get me these herbs, which are like St. John's wort or propolis, these things. And they're, we were Russian, so they sound a little better in Russian, the words, or echinacea and things like that. So again, I was kind of skeptical at the time as I, you know, began to understand research and education and things like that. It helped to kind of put the pieces together on where do all of these concepts fit in? How do they all work together? So bottom line is my father passing at 41 and seeing a lot of the disease around me and many other friends' family, cancers, Alzheimer's, Parkinson's, things like that. I the more I understood it and began to research it, the more I saw a lot of this was preventable. And so one of my goals was to say, you know, I don't want to die at 41. I want to help other people prevent this very small things that they can change, like, again, something as simple as eating too much bread, let's say. That might be a super oversimplification, and that's not going to work for everyone, but the basic concept of Alzheimer's, that's something that, again, has been in the those conversations around what Alzheimer's actually is calling it type 3 diabetes. So there's type 1 and type 2 diabetes are very common, unfortunately, also. And the way that they're even handled, especially type 2 diabetes, I would say, that's type 1 is the one you're generally born with. Type 2 is the one you develop, usually coming from sparking your insulin, your blood sugar too much, and your pancreas, which produces insulin, eventually says like, I'm out, tap out, I can't do this anymore. You've abused me, and I've run out of insulin that I can create. So bottom line for me is someone who's in that risk factor. So now we, you know, again, the medical system has said and started to label folks as pre-diabetic. So what does that mean to me is very simply, let's spike your insulin less and less. There's a lot of these kind of the glucose hypothesis of disease. So things that, again, spike your blood sugar might be leading to, again, all these kind of diseases down the line. So I'm way oversimplifying and glossing over a lot of, nuance to this whole thing. But that is the time and culture that we live in. But if you're listening to this, if you're watching this, I really appreciate it. And again, I'm trying to share this to, again, explain kind of where I come from. So my let's jump over to my kind of athletic and just the career that got me to where I am today. When I was in high school playing football, I loved sports. I grew up, again, in this very sports active population. Again, I took karate in junior high school. I was almost a black belt. I quit that to play on my high school football team. And my mother would get me swimming lessons. We live right by the beach in Coney Island. I still remember them fondly and you know, learning the breaststroke on the sand and trying to make kind of like snow angels. That was something that certainly stands out to me. But again, this culture and kind of ingrained just physical importance of movement, of health. My mother would swim all the time. I actually have a tattoo which has my last name in it for my father, because I'm the last one with the last name. And for my mother, there's a doll. It's inside of a dolphin. So the dolphin is her because she swims all the time. So living in Coney Island, Seagate, we were right by the ocean, and she would swim almost every chance she had. She loved to swim. So that certainly like inspired me. And that's another thing that, again, I stands out in my mind of, you know, you what you're surrounded by, that kind of breeds that culture. And if you're not working out as a parent, I think it can be tiresome. I'm not here to judge people by any means, but it can certainly be something that is that feedback loop. So I played football as I had an injury my senior year as a quarterback. I was the starting quarterback, but I like nearly broke my ankle. It wasn't that bad. It was like a grade 2 sprain. And so when I was recovering from that, that was kind of the one of those impetus moments as I went to the chiropractor, who was our team doctor at the time. And again, for my sprained ankle, he cracked my back, which I was like, what is this? I want to figure this one out. And at the time, I was actually debating between the medical field and working with athletes, sports medicine, versus kind of sports casting, because I knew I wanted to do something with sports. I love sports very much. And it took me to the medicine side, ultimately. I interned with our chiropractor, Dr. Dreyfus, who's still practicing in Midwood, Brooklyn, right by, which I didn't know at the time when I was there. I figured out when I was much older, DeFara Pizza is considered one of the best pizzerias in the world. And I have since obviously had it, but at the time, as in high school and things like that, I certainly didn't understand how amazing this pizza was until I got out in the world and like everyone's like, hey, this pizza place, I was right there, DeFara Pizza. I could talk for an hour on just that pizza, but I'm gonna skip past that. So then I went freshman year in college, Wagner College in Staten Island. I was playing football. 9/11 actually happened and probably shook me to my core a bit. I'm sure like it did many other folks. Kind of moved away from the football side. I knew I wasn't gonna make it as a professional athlete. Wasn't enjoying the practices and things like that. And obviously, again, like not where we were, by the way, 9/11 in Staten Island at the top of this hill, you could see downtown Manhattan. So it was very kind of potent and right there in front of our faces. So it was very, very powerful thing at the time, obviously. And many people obviously have very different experiences. But yeah, so that at the time I was actually pre-med because I went from being chiropractor and no offense, any chiropractor, but I was like, oh, that's like kind of fake doctors, partly because of the Simpsons episode where they make fun of chiropractors at the time. And then I was like, I'm going to be an orthopedic surgeon. And I interned with the Brooklyn Tech, my high school's orthopedic surgeon that we were connected to. He was actually very close to Wagner College. I would go down the little hill there and he was very close. And I would spend some time in that office. And, you know, again, it didn't, I only saw the in the office time. I didn't see the surgeries. But at the time, that certainly didn't appeal to me of going one room, kind of injecting someone, going in another room, you know, pulling something out of someone's knee with a needle. At the time, I was kind of like, I don't really get this. Like, it's not, doesn't connect with me. But he spoke about someone who was about to have a total knee replacement. And, hey, our physical therapist is great. You're going to really have a lot of fun. You know, let's say Michael, whatever, I don't remember the guy's name, but he's like, yeah, Michael's great. He's going to take you through a whole bunch of stuff and you know, it's going to, you're going to have a good time. So I was like, that sounds like more maybe what I want to check out. So I started looking into physical therapy, and that really was like the first time I understood that concept. And that was, you know, the moment. And I shifted over to that career path. I switched colleges. I went to pre-physical therapy school, which I didn't actually need to do in retrospect, but at the time the guidance counselor didn't quite know. Again, physical therapy back then, even to today, almost 20 years later, probably still some ambiguity about what it is, how the career path is. Most people are kind of like, it's an allied profession. So if it's not a school that specializes in it, again, even that guidance counselor at Wagner College didn't really know what this was, what that process was, because there weren't a lot of people doing it at the time, let alone, again, still, I'm sure it's much better now with the way information just is easier to access. But at the time, switched over to Mount St. Mary College, we had a pre-physical therapy program, got my bachelor's there in psychology, because the tracks were either you can get a bachelor's in biology or psychology for the pre-physical therapy that led to applying for physical therapy school where you can get your doctorate. And so that's that path that took me to there. So got my bachelor's 2005, got into Long Island University, Brooklyn campus. So I decided to stay in the Brooklyn area with my family still there. And also right across the street from my high school, actually, Brooklyn Tech, which was a cool thing. And I actually, during physical therapy school, a few of the semesters that were, I enjoyed very much, but allowed me a little bit of freedom in how I studied and the way I like to study. And so I was actually able to coach at my high school, which was a pretty cool experience for a football team, which again was one of my fond experiences. Again, bond created some serious bonds with some of the other coaches and even some of the players. It was a really cool time. There's a brotherhood there that we actually just had one of our first 20 years later almost, well, not from the coaching, but from the playing days of a Zoom call with like 20 something guys on there from those like 97 to 2000 years of playing. So again, it's a powerful thing. If you don't have any kind of network like that, there's new ones that certainly can be created. So if you're looking for any kind of connections, which I think everyone needs some version of that, and there's a lot of power in that connectivity. So let me not go too far down that tangent talking about my path again, going back to that, getting selfish. So 3 years, Long Island University, Brooklyn campus, took me through, I got one of my clinicals. So it's a clinical doctorate, something that again, a lot of people don't understand when I say I'm a doctor of physical therapy. They think it's a PhD, which is an academic doctorate. It's a little different. Clinical doctorate, at least half of that schooling, 3 years, is really meant to be based in a clinical setting. So you're working with a professional clinician, a physical therapist, and you're the student. And so you have that communication, that relationship where you are, you know, growing, getting your independence, getting proficient at the practice of physical therapy, which again, lasts forever. You know, 50 years into your career, you're still practicing medicine, you're practicing physical therapy. So that's kind of been the process there. Got my doctorate, again, 2008. And in the clinical settings, I got to go to Philadelphia for whatever it was, 12 weeks, or maybe that was 3 months. 3 months, 12 weeks, same thing. that was one of my last clinicals. Very cool experience working with spinal cord injury patients. fun fact there, one morning I was walking, it was 2008, I think. Anyway, and I was the DNC going on in Philadelphia, and as I was walking, kind of had my headphones on, and Secret Service stopped me. It was actually Obama walking right by from the DNC, where him and Hillary were kind of, I guess, going at it at the time, you know, competing for the presidential, the Democratic nomination. So anyway, that was a fun little fact. And where I was also, you had a lot of the basketball teams stopping. So one time the Denver Nuggets, you know, their bus kind of came in from the airport, I guess. And they were, as again, I was walking, I was like, oh, hey, Denver Nugget people. Anyway, so very cool time there. Moving on, my career started, did some time at Hospital for Special Surgery, where I did one of my, again, clinical rotations, considered to be the number one hospital for orthopedics in the world, many, many times over U.S. News and World Report. They are, I use the term factory only because it's like, it's such a well-run machine. And so, again, that was a cool experience to see some of, the top surgeons in the world, make some great connections, see how they do things, and learn a ton from them. I didn't really want to be in the hospital system so much, so I actually switched over to a clinic in Midtown Manhattan, Star Physical Therapy at the time. It's now Motion PT. Again, still keep in touch with some of those lovely people I met there to this day. And again, got 18 months there was kind of the agreement to do 9 months. They had 2 floors, 9 months with one of the owners. Of doing more focus on the lower body and more sports kind of rehab. And the other one was 9 months more low back, shoulders, neck kind of focus. So they had kind of divided and conquered these areas of the body and these diagnoses, and the way they had that business set up was very cool. Pretty busy clinic, but it was very well run again, and learned a ton there for those 18 months. That kind of was what now would be more of like a residency or almost a fellowship of kind of, you know, after you graduate, you start to focus a little bit more on what it is you want to specialize in. Again, the profession of physical therapy is so varied. Now you have pelvic health PT, you have neurology. My earpiece, I think, just died. So hopefully you guys can hear me all right. So that was cool. Then as I finished that, I did spend some time, that was when I discovered CrossFit. One of the patients at Star Physical Therapy was like, came in, was like, yeah, I really want to get back to CrossFit. I want to deadlift like 400 pounds. Da, da, da. He had like a hip surgery. So like, what are you talking about? What is this thing? And he's like, I actually think you would like it a lot. You know, we had spoken a bit. And so he introduced me to it. I started doing CrossFit in a church basement, CrossFit Gotham on 50th and Lexington in Manhattan. They only had classes at 5, 6, 7 a.m. It was very like Fight Club style, you know, it wasn't any like, you know, key card or anything like that. You had to call the guy or text the guy. Someone would come open the door for you. We were in the basement of this church. You had to open the closet, bring out all the equipment. And it was very cool exposure to that. I definitely fell in love with the concept of CrossFit. Before that, I'd been doing triathlon and running, which I got really into when I was in Philadelphia, actually. I got into a lot of those like endurance type sports. I wanted to, you know, build this kind of fitness routine that I'd probably been missing more consistently. So it was a good way to explore Philadelphia. Also, my time running, that kind of sparked it. It's one of my first times living outside of New York City. So anyway, jumping back to finding CrossFit, because I was starting to get into CrossFit, the guy who actually introduced me was a pretty successful business fella, and we were trying to open a CrossFit in New York City. The real estate was quite a pain, if you can imagine. You know, rent starting at $20,000 a month for kind of a smaller space, probably the size of my garage here. And so that was quite a process, and I was looking, and basically because of that, I started working at Lenox Hill Hospital. Again, the timing and the network allowed me to kind of be in a good situation to do hours there. And again, still some awesome people I keep in touch with, really good friends that I made there that, again, opened up all sorts of opportunities for me. I think being in New York City, you're going to find if you have some talent that it just opens up all these cool experiences. It's a very cool place to be. So, moving on. So that eventually, as I was looking for space, again, jump to this side story, found a space, but it was the same week I got a random invitation, like I was talking about these opportunities, these networks, to be the private physical therapist for a celebrity. So that was an opportunity I really couldn't pass up. They were very kind of not aggressive in a bad way, but they were aggressive like, hey, do you have a passport? Are you married? Are you single? Like, let's go. Here's the contract. Look it over. If it works for you, let's go. And he had a private jet. You know, we flew all over. It was a very cool experience there too. I helped him get ready for a surgery, and then rehab him. Again, we went down to Jamaica and did 2 weeks there as part of the rehab process. He wanted to recuperate and recover. So, very cool experience. After that, little stint there, traveling around with that guy. I came back to New York City, had a nice bit of extra, you know, cash ready to go, and I was in a pretty cool situation. I wasn't paying a ton in rent for New York City, and stayed in that fitness space, started coaching a little bit more CrossFit with a little bit of physical therapy, you know, mixed in, and that led to an offer, again networking, to go and open a CrossFit gym in Dubai in the United Arab Emirates, UAE, Middle East. So again, for those not that familiar, a lot of people were asking me like, hey, are you gonna get your hand chopped off if you do stuff? Like a lot of interesting stuff that people think about that area. Of course, Dubai did a very good job. The kind of the alternative to that, or the extreme opposite of that, of people being like, is everything made of gold there? Like, you know, it looks like very, very cool place on Instagram. And so I ended up spending 2.5 years there. The gym and kind of the bubble of it all the economy and everything, I would say, was kind of starting to fizzle a little bit. You know, again, learned a ton of lessons there. Again, made very cool friends. And I met my wife, Dr. Maha, sexual healing doc there. And so we ended up moving back to New York City. When I was in Dubai, I'll say, I started doing virtual coaching, which takes me to kind of where I am today. And brings us full circle to this preventative model. And, you know, I let kind of each of those opportunities kind of excite me and bring me to different places and see a lot of the world and meet all sorts of cool people. But it now, as I came back to New York City, wanted to kind of double down, getting married, getting a dog, starting to like, okay, what are the next stages in life? What am I really passionate about? And again, I'm very grateful that